for it to go.
So, quick question. Now, before I introduce the show, because I was about to introduce the show, and I thought, you know, actually, I'm just going to start with this question because I'm not sure. Is this actually the first episode we've ever done of this show? Have we done a bad fight breakdown show before?
I don't know. We've done bad card breakdowns. Have we ever done a thing where we dedicated on doing bad fights?
I don't know either. So let's just call this episode one. Welcome, everyone, to episode one of the MMA Depressed Us, our off event week show where we're going to look at three terrible, god-awful, shit-tastic fights in UFC history. Well, we may stretch outside UFC history, but it's going to have to be all fight pass stuff because we want it to be easy to sync, easy for other people to find, easy for other people to get their hands on, and to know exactly where we are in the content. So, we're going to be watching three terrible fights. Myself, joined by Connor Rebish. Hello. We may tie in some other unfortunate soul if we can.
Sure.
But we will see down the road.
I mean, there's a certain point you reach, Zane, after you watch enough fights where you just have to appreciate a bad fight.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, I'm actually really looking forward to this because we've chosen fights, too, that I have not rewatched since they aired.
Like, Why would you?
You know, these are fights that you do not go back and voluntarily put yourself through. And so I have only these vague impressions, these overarching memories. It's almost folklore at this point, you know, like these bad fights. It's like, oh, remember when Jan Patrick defeated Sir Daniel in that terrible, god-awful piece of combat. My mind is sketchy, but I'm sure these titans clashed in a vat of oil and limbs, you know? I mean...
Sometimes, too, you will rewatch them and you'll find a way, you will realize that they're maybe not as awful as you remember. Like, sometimes a mediocre fight occurs in the middle of an awful card and it really becomes, you know, like, you don't want to have any slow point is 10 times slower when everything surrounding it is bad and slow. So, like, I actually rewatched Nate Quarry versus Khalib Starnes, a legendary bad fight, and it's not actually as bad as I thought it would be. It's not terrible. Like, Khalib Starnes throws a few punches, too. It's not just Khalib Starnes running. It's just that, like...
That's the image.
Yeah, the image of him being chased around, that's what we were left with, and so it exaggerates over time. So maybe we'll discover some gems here. I kind of doubt it.
I kind of doubt it, too. We're going to try and select pretty heavily for things that we remember as being particularly awful.
Yeah, so why don't we tell people what three fights we're watching so that they can... queue up with us. We had three criteria, Zane. We had we wanted to have a good bad fight, a fight that was bad but which you remember being enjoyable.
Yeah,
that's gonna be
Dan Kelly versus Patrick Walsh. So that's the first one you can queue up. That is our good bad fight this week.
Yep, and then we've got Gabriel Gonzaga versus Konstantin Irokin, which is our bad fight. It's a fight that is not only not technical and it's just not fun to watch. It's going to be bad.
No names, no big names. Gonzaga, well, you know, whatever, but no big names, no technical, no sloppiness, no fun, just badness.
Yes.
We got to have one fight that's just bad.
And then we went for a disappointing fight, a big fight that was supposed to be great that was disappointing. And for that, how could we go with anything other for our inaugural episode than George St. Pierre versus Jake Shields at UFC 129, one of GSP's most uninteresting fights. And there are people out there who would say that he had a lot of those. So it's even as a big GSP fan, someone who thinks that he is undeniably the greatest of all time, it's not a good fight. So that's what we've got queued up. We talked, Zane, about skipping past the Zuffa Wright's page on Fight Pass and queuing it up there, but one of these videos does not have that. So one of them starts with a different logo that I think is 1 second shorter. So do you want to skip to the start of the tail of the tape?
Because let's do that. That actually makes a little more sense. Let me mute and find the tail of the tape and we'll...
As long as the GSP Shields video starts with one before the walkout.
So we want, yeah, we want when the tail of the tape appears on screen, right? So we're going to skip past the explainer intros and all that. There it is. Let me...
Not the second tail of the tape when both men have entered the cage, but the one which introduces the fight.
Oh, okay. So you want the just the very first thing that comes up.
Yeah, or... and so that's the thing. GSP Shields on Fight Pass doesn't have one of those.
Okay.
So we want to have a little time before each fight starts for us to talk about what's coming.
Why don't you know what? The disclaimer is only a few seconds long. Why don't we just start each video at the beginning?
Start of the video. That works fine, plain and simple. So
there you go. We're overthinking. Said,
we're using Fight Pass so that it's easy. So if you got Fight Pass and if you don't, I'm not being paid by Zuffa, but I wholly recommend it. It's a great service to have if you like watching fights. Then go ahead and get it and queue up with us. You can get a 7-day trial if you.
It's made itself more and more essential over time.
Yeah, definitely. It's a much better service than it was, and it was already good enough to overlook most of its flaws just because it had fights. So you get a 7-day free trial. You can enjoy ripping off Zuffa by getting some free fights and then canceling immediately after the show if you want to join us.
That's right. So, that's our plan for this show, and we're going to try and continue it in the future going forward. We'll be taking suggestions. If you want to leave comments on YouTube for suggestions in the future, you're free to do that. If you want to hit up either of us on Twitter in between shows, that's also not a terrible idea. You can find me on Twitter at TheZaneSimon. You can find Connor on Twitter at BoxingBush, B-U-S-C-H. And... there's also email. We'll be posting this video over at Bloody Elbow 2, so you can comment there. There are many ways to deliver us more horrible fight ideas. I don't think we're ever really going to run out of these, so we can keep doing this for
a lot of these are recent. Like, they keep coming.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's no shortage. We could be talking about Adriano Martins versus Leonardo Santos right now.
Sure. I didn't actually find that fight to be awful. I don't know. I didn't watch the card live, so maybe just like skipping through all the stuff in between fights made it more tolerable to me.
Maybe. That it was a bad fight, but
it wasn't great. It wasn't great.
All right. So we'll keep getting more of these to talk about, and hopefully, my babbling here will give you enough time to queue these up if queuing them up is something you want to do. Connor's just dropped out, so I have to wait anymore now. This is just our little idea to bring something new for our non-fight weeks. Cause we can't stop the grind. Even if Zuffa it's not Zuffa. Even if the UFC feels like they can these days. So
WMEIMG now, right?
Yeah. WMEIMG.
Not as catchy as Zuffa.
Not as catchy as Zuffa at all. All right. So on that note, should we just dive into the first one?
Let's do it. We will do a synchronized countdown. So in case you are not aware what we're doing, we're going to be watching Dan Kelly versus Patrick Walsh.
And we're going to be starting it at the beginning of the Fight Pass video from moment one of the Fight Pass video. So if you're going to go with us, you just start it at the beginning. No need to do any extra queuing, anything like that. And we will be going after one.
3, 2, 1, go.
3, 2, 1, go. Do not go on one. Nobody goes on one.
I think I might have if you hadn't told me that, Zane.
This is your Lethal Weapon inspired countdown instructions. It's 3, 2, 1, go. Nobody goes on one.
But that wasn't the countdown. Shit, I just started it.
No.
Just kidding. All right, I'm ready. I'm ready when you are.
All right. 3, 2, 1, go.
I have gone. I'm looking at you.
You have gone. We are right here. We are starting Dan Kelly versus Patrick Walsh. This is from way back. It just says UFC Fight Night. What event was this? Do you remember?
I will Wikipedia it right now while we're doing the walkouts.
Yeah, I feel like we should have been better prepared on this, but we're just trying to, get into the flow of this, figure it out as we go along.
All right. It's fun to just kind of feel it out as we go. So Dan Kelly and Patrick Walsh met at UFC Fight Night, Henderson versus Thatch, which is a very enjoyable card, on the 14th of February, 2015. So this is probably our most recent bad fight. Oh, actually, yeah. I think Irokin Gonzaga might be more recent.
Yeah, and Irokin Gonzaga was more recent. And both these guys are tough vets. They came off different seasons of tough, I believe, with Kelly being off the... Canada versus international Canada Australia tough, wasn't that, was that what it was?
Yeah, I think so. Tough Smashes, Canada versus Australia. I think so.
Yeah, for that bitter Canada versus Australia rivalry.
You know, it's been raging for years.
And Patrick Walsh was off one of those generic seasons I barely remember. I think that might have been the one Eddie Gordon won.
Let's just say ahead of time, before we do this, Dan Kelly has an excuse for this fight. He's 37.
Yeah.
He spent his career doing judo and not throwing punches. Now, judoka tend to make pretty good transfers for the striking arts because of the grip fighting and the distancing, but Patrick Walsh has no viable excuse for this fight. And we're about to begin, so if you need to queue up again, round one, I'll say go when round one starts for me, because we've got the ring girl, we've got Dan Kelly, we've got Patrick Walsh, and the fight begins.
Patrick Walsh's love handles.
Now. Yes, Patrick Walsh's delicious love handles.
It should be said, too, as we get started here, that Kelly has – he has notably improved. Like, his MMA career was really short before this started, this fight, and he has improved a ton. So
– yeah. And he wasn't actually even that bad in this fight. I think it was just an ugly style matchup.
It's a very – oh, man, it's already kind of an ugly style.
Yeah, it's just, like, two guys who aren't very good. Like, Kelly kind of needs you to, like, to be good so he can throw his sloppy shit around your technical strikes. And neither of these guys is that clean of a striker. We've got some nice, messy right hooks from Patrick Walsh here.
Yeah, he really loved going to that weird – that funky hook combination. I'm trying to think of what other lazy boxer he reminds me of in MMA that just – has like much less punching technique than they think they do. You know who he reminds me of? Clay Collard.
Oh, that's a good one. My pick is my pick was going to be the striking of Matt Hamill.
Yeah, that also works. So he's actually landing a few of these hooks though.
Yeah,
Kelly is stiff as hell and is very. That's what makes this fight such a great, fun trash fire of a bout. Yeah. Is that both of these guys are dedicated to being pressure fighters.
Yeah, so they're both standing toe-to-toe, trading these awful punches. And I got to say, like, some of these counters are pretty good from Patrick Walsh. His timing is pretty good.
Yeah,
his technique is lackluster. But
yeah, he's got the right idea of, like, when and how to fire.
What I like is that Patrick Walsh throws these shots, and then he rolls underneath, which is great. Like, head movement's great. But he, like, rests his elbows and his legs when he does it. Like, it's like a tired man getting out of a chair. It's not, like, a confident athletic motion.
It's, like it's also one of those things where it's kind of a little too, like, what do you really expect to be coming back at you that you're rolling like this? Like, you might actually want to plan the defense for the opponent.
Yeah. Well, so far, I think Patrick Walsh is actually kind of comfortably winning this round.
Oh, sure. Yeah. He absolutely is. He's landed all the harder shots. He's slipped enough to not get hit a lot. And Kelly just looks like he has been carved out of wood and is being operated by little thumb switches in the back.
He looks like something from a Jim Henson movie.
With a knee brace, of course.
Yeah, Kelly does. He has the posture of an old man. Like, he looks like he's had some back injuries in his time. He's very stiff.
It's like Dan Henderson if you took out all the sort of scary athletic power.
Sure. And if you straightened his neck.
And if you straightened his neck, yeah.
Dan's got this old man hunch that he can't possibly – he can't pull himself out of it anymore. So, yeah, I think right now we kind of – it seems like we have – Kelly is aligning himself with the idea of making – of making Walsh lead, because Walsh is very effective when he's countering Kelly's shots. And so now Kelly is kind of pulled back and he's blocking some shots pretty well there. It's not pretty, but they're not getting through anymore the way they were before.
Well, I think part of it too is that Walsh's pace is so consistent and absolutely the same. Like, he has this very set tempo he's fighting at that is absolutely predictable. And Kelly, to his credit, is starting to predict that. Like,
yeah, he's changing rhythm, too. Snappy jab there. We had a couple feints from Dan Kelly. Like, I think Dan Kelly is kind of a natural fighter. He gets it. He doesn't look all that smooth, but he's very cool under pressure. And he's, like, he's poised enough that he can think and plan. Like here he is, he's timing that counter hook from Walsh and making him throw it with his jab and then countering him as he throws it. Smart stuff.
Still entirely arm punches from Dan Kelly.
Oh, like, absolutely.
There is not an ounce of body movement to go with those punches at all.
No, there is not.
It's really kind of, and it's weird because the tempo is so even in this fight that, like, that's kind of what makes it such a weirdly bad fight. Like, even though there's lots of action, it's such a bad fight to watch because you just, like, you completely slip into this malaise where the fact that they've been fighting constantly for 5 minutes doesn't really matter at all. Like, oh, and a big takedown out of nowhere from Walsh to actually probably seal that round for
probably.
Him.
Probably. Kelly got comfortable at the end of the round, but he didn't really score very much. He got a couple jabs in, clipped him with a couple left hands, but most of the clean shots were from Walsh for sure.
Yeah. By the midpoint of that round, Walsh had stopped landing nearly as many clean shots, but that takedown at the end pretty much steals it for him. And that kind of came out of nowhere, too. Because like I say, you're getting like – you had 4 minutes and 55 seconds where you basically got this very low-paced, comfortable brawl.
You see the same counters, the same tempo, the same speed. You don't expect anything different to happen at any point. So a takedown is actually quite a shock.
Both guys look – Kelly's looking a little tired there for a round in which he probably threw actually quite a lot. But
yeah. I got to say, I think Walsh actually started to slow down a little bit at the end of that round. More like...
Well, you see how he throws everything. It's impossible for him not to slow down. He is swinging... He's swinging not from his... He's swinging from his knees. Like, that part of that whole roll thing is like he literally is dropping his fist down to his knee and then trying to swing it up at Dan Kelly. Mm-hmm. And he's going right back to the same tempo, which is making him less effective. It's making it easier for Kelly to fire off these... quick little arm punches of his.
Yeah, he's wading into some pretty good straight punches from Kelly. Well timed, if not like beautiful to look at.
Definitely not beautiful to look at.
The thing is, too, watching this, there are things I like about what Walsh is doing here. He's got his head off center. Mm-hmm. He's creating some distance between his chin and his opponent's fists, whereas Kelly's kind of leaned forward and hunching in. But his attack, the way he uses that position is becoming rapidly very, very predictable.
Yeah, it's somebody like he's obviously had some very good boxing basics of movement training. Yeah. Like that little hook combo he threw just now where you did like a lead right hook and then a big left hook immediately following it, that was actually kind of nice. It caught Kelly way off.
This is all getting kind of nice. He is just walking into counters from Dan Kelly. Dan Kelly's jab is so much better than I thought it was. I did not remember him dominating this awful fight with his jab, but he is, it's actually really nice.
He just lost his mouthpiece too, by the way, for those watching at home. That skittered across the canvas and everybody's looking a little confused because we've officially entered the point where Walsh has upped his tempo of hooks by like a half step and Kelly has upped his straight punching game. And so now everything is just Kelly or Walsh comes in throwing two hooks and Kelly answers it with two straight punches. And that's what we're getting basically ad infinitum right now.
Yeah, it just kind of looks like a fight where Kelly is enjoying the opportunity to think and Walsh only thinks when he has to. Like it's a very automatic pace for him, very automatic with his attacks, and that can be a good thing. But when he does think about what to do next, it's because Kelly has walked him into like 10 jabs in a row. Whereas Kelly is getting to think. He doesn't have to. He gets to think. He's enjoying the opportunity to pick Walsh off as he comes in.
Man, Kelly's defense, though, is so just, let me lean barely out of the way of this huge hook that's going to clip me still right in the face.
Yeah, sneaky little uppercut there. Did you see that before? Kelly walks in with a jab and then an arm punch uppercut. It actually made it more effective. It was like a bolo punch. He didn't get his body into it, and so it didn't take any time to come after the jab. It was actually kind of nice.
This is still such like a weirdly – it's such a lulling brawl. Like, if you think of a brawl, like, at some point we probably get to it of O'Donnell versus Bossy.
Oh, yeah.
Which I don't even know if we'd get to that. That was
I don't think that qualifies as a bad fight. That was an amazing fight.
It was an amazing fight.
Yeah.
But like that brawl is with constant changes of tempo and just like all these speed switches and all that constant back and forth. This is so constantly, I don't know, like there's a lot going on, but at the same time, there's absolutely nothing going on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, both guys are getting hit all the time with everything they throw, and yet there's no danger. There's no, like, is somebody about to get hurt? It just seems like nobody could ever get hurt doing this somehow. When even though they could obviously both get hurt a lot.
Mm-hmm.
What is that jump in that
I don't know. It's some kind of drop step. That? It was some kind of feint. I'm torn between saying that Kelly's footwork is better here, except that when Kelly is the one who's actually using distance to his advantage, but he has this weird thing where his feet are fully planted and his weight is fully committed every time he punches. He's got this kind of wrestler stance that he's stuck in.
Yeah.
All on his front foot, hips look very stiff. And so when he's actually engaging those hips and trying to punch, he's completely locked into place. But Walsh's footwork is, his feet are all over the place whenever he's punching.
He moved like an ape from Planet of the Apes. Like a man trying to move like an ape, you know?
Someone imitating an ape.
Yeah, that's very much the movement that you see here in this fight. That was actually a good right, a good straight left from Kelly right there.
Mm-hmm. Kelly's definitely winning this round.
It's because Walsh keeps leaping in like he is. Ooh, just
sharp jab too.
Walsh is leaping in like he's about to throw some fecal matter. Like that's
if Walsh would throw some straight punches, like he would reap the benefits of his stance. But everything is a hook.
Yeah.
His left hand is a hook. He never throws a jab, but even his jab is like this weird, when it does appear to be an attempt at a jab, it's a swing.
Oh, and man. This is, okay, this is starting to, aw. And see, the round just ended. Like, it was just getting to the final, like, tipping point of this weird trash style, and then
Kelly definitely won that round. Really crisp jabs to start off this round. Walsh is getting worse and worse with every passing minute.
I can't imagine how his shoulders take this kind of style. Right.
Yeah, I'm expecting a Korean zombie moment at some point in his future.
Yeah, like it's just you're torquing your shoulder over that much on everything, and that's got to be bad for your rotator cuff.
Sure. Yeah.
Nice hooking left hand from Walsh there, but it's still like the same single punch that he has thrown this whole fight.
You know what, too? I think the thing is here is that Walsh is staying competitive in terms of volume. He's definitely landing,
uh-huh,
but he's not landing clean. Like even when he catches a perfect opening, he's catching Kelly with the inside of his glove. Like here, he's kind of slapping him with his punches.
Well, he also, you notice too, he moves away at the same moment he throws the punch.
Yeah.
Like as the punch lands, he's stepping back, which means that he's taking his own force off of it.
Yeah, I mean that can work for a hook, but even then, it's like his feet aren't really that set.
Yeah, like he's, you know, he'll throw these big punches and they look like they should have power on them, but even when they land, he's often moving away right at the moment, and Kelly is also just kind of unbreakable.
Kelly's got the ideal old man defense here, where Dan Henderson does the same thing, where he's kind of stiff and he's not that quick, and so every time that Walsh does anything, Kelly just jabs and he just catches all those punches on the outside of his arm. Like watch here. Yep. He'll throw his jab out and he'll block the overhand left of Walsh by extending the jab. It's like a go-to one size fits all response for everything. Like there we go. We got a forearm block. Jack Dempsey called that a glance off. It's a really nice, Andre Ward uses it a lot, not to invoke the name of Andre Ward in this, this fight, but
It is at least, you know, and that's the thing, it is at least a constantly entertaining fight. It is one of those that, like, I lose the steam of interest of, like, what's going to happen, because I know what's going to happen. They're going to keep doing this for another 3 minutes. But it does have that, you know, there's always something being exchanged here, which, you know, it's at least, it's going to be the nice part of watching these sloppy ass fights.
Definitely.
Ooh, you know what would be a good one for that at some point in the future? Krylov Palele.
Oh, God. That's a terrible fight.
Now, that was actually a nice right hook.
Yeah, we had him hooking off the jab, and he caught Kelly. He actually got back to countering for a moment because he has, like, thoughtlessly allowed Kelly to get him to lead for most of this fight ever since that first round.
Yep.
Really nice counter jab from Kelly, too.
No, Kelly's staying busy. Like, you can see why, you can see clearly how and why Kelly has improved in this fight, because it's like everything is so wooden and so clunky. You know, Walsh is kind of starting to win this round.
Yeah, he's actually landing. But again, like, look at how these shots are landing. It's like the inside of the palm. It's the digits. He's not. Every time Kelly connects with that jab, it is four knuckles to face. Every time. And a lot of Walsh's shots, like, they're around the back of the head or on the shoulders, and it's just kind of slapping and glancing. They're not clean blows the way that they could be, given the openings that, you know, Kelly's non-existent defense is giving him.
Yeah, but like, if scoring this, I might put Walsh ahead, maybe, because at the very least, he's landing the more consistent power shots.
The last minute, yeah.
Yeah, he seems like over the round, he's put the better shots on Kelly. Although Kelly now is starting to, well, kind of, I don't know. Now we're just getting into both guys blocking everything with their face, which...
Yeah, well, Walsh actually jabbed there. Kelly was like, all right, I got to come back and win, and Walsh actually just touched him with the jab. Look, he's jabbing. He waited until the final 30 seconds of the third round to do it, but he's jabbing.
It's remarkable. And still ugly. Man, Kelly, he threw a faint jab and Walsh stepped back, and the amount of power that had to go into Walsh to lift his feet up and move forward, or amount of power that had to go into Kelly to lift his feet up and move forward, rather, was kind of amazing.
Yeah, there was a jarring jab to Walsh's jaw right there at the last 10 seconds.
Kelly really has to, like, he has to move heaven and earth to get his feet to go, like, any faster than a slow trundle.
That's why I think, especially when he's punching, that's why I think that was a good strategy to try to make Walsh counter and then counter his counters, because he couldn't – Kelly wasn't effective anytime he tried to close the distance there, because even he couldn't even close distance with Walsh. His head was far away. That made it too difficult. But he could plant his feet and be just far enough away that when Walsh swung and missed, he could hit him with a jab.
So Kelly won this fight, right, by the judges?
He just got the nod.
Yeah. Kelly won the fight. I don't know that I would have given it to him necessarily on a rewatch, but
it's crazy to say he may not have won that fight, and since he has had two very impressive wins.
And he had we spent the whole fight kind of talking about what he was doing better than Walsh all fight, but he still ate a shit ton of punches straight to his head.
Well, that's why that fight is still enjoyable. Like, fighting is not all about just being pretty and technical. Sometimes it's just about having guts and going after somebody. And that's why Walsh or Kelly maybe didn't win that fight, despite the fact that, throughout the whole thing, all we could really talk about is how ugly everything Walsh did was, and how there was actually evident thought going into Kelly's actions. Walsh just kept coming after him, man. You got to give him his props for that. So
yeah.
It was a close fight. I'm almost surprised the decision was unanimous, because I could see some people disagreeing about that nod.
Yeah, I think it. I was actually I kind of assumed it was a split decision, because we're watching with the sound off, obviously, or at least I am. I don't know if you are, but
Walsh missed weight for that fight as well. That is not a good look when you're coming in with a muffin top that pronounced.
Yeah, that is not the Alex Oliveira tactical miss.
No. No, not at all. Shall we move on?
The cheeseburger and fries.
that's the I wish I was at heavyweight miss. Yeah.
Yeah.
Shall we move on to our next fight?
Shall we? Yeah, we should move on to Gonzaga versus Arakin now.
We're getting too excited, so we may as well dampen the mood by watching it.
That was predictably enjoyable. Maybe it has still had some of those elements, but maybe a little overstated on the night when I talked about it being two guys being pushed together and strapped to shopping carts. But there's still a lot of that feeling where they just both seemed to, like, because they were so dedicated to pressure fighting, it was just these constant, like, bring them together, throw two punches, bring them apart, bring them together, throw two punches, bring them apart.
Yeah, it was like Walsh was incapable of fighting with the amount of thought that Kelly was putting into it. And Kelly was incapable of turning the amount of thinking he was doing. Like, he was physically incapable of really taking advantage of that. So he was
physically incapable of pivoting his body or moving it in any kind of rapid way.
Yes. I fully expect that at some point, someday, Dan Kelly will literally just break in half in the octagon. The man who does not bend breaks, and Dan Kelly does not bend.
He does not. All right. Shall we start our Konstantin Arakin Gabriel Gonzaga fight?
I've got it queued up. I'm ready when you are.
All right. 3, 2, 1, go.
UFC Fight Pass logo, is that what you have?
It just dove right. Oh, shoot. You know what? I'm actually going to pause it for a few seconds.
Let's restart.
Okay, let's restart. Damn it. I forgot and didn't set it back. I set it to queue where it should have.
That's
where we talked about previously and whatever. Anyway,
requeuing. Gabriel Gonzaga versus Konstantin Arakin.
This is the Olympic swimming starting gun where one of us jumped in the pool.
False start.
Okay, false start. Restart, back up. 3, 2, 1, go. Okay.
Fight pass logo.
We're good.
Fade to black. Tale of the tape. Or not tale of the tape, fight introduction.
So, for those of you who are not familiar with me, and I can't imagine you watching this if you're not familiar with me, just purely out of curiosity, if you're here purely out of curiosity, then I had a lot of hopes for Konstantin Arakin. And that's part of why I picked this fight, because this is sort of one of those, like, hope-killing fights for me, where it's just like, okay, I really need to give up this dream.
This is a shameful fight.
This is a shameful, terrible fight. Now, the retrospect of it is that Arakin apparently broke his hand in the fight. But the truth of it is that this is also the culmination of where his UFC fights were heading anyway. Like, he was slowly getting to be this fighter in the UFC, which is somebody that's too cautious to be offensive because their limitations are too massive.
So why were you hyped on him when he came into the UFC? Because I joined you, by the way. I think on the Vivisection where we talked about this, I also was like, yeah, he looks like he has potential to be a great heavyweight.
He's a good athlete. He looks like a good, functional, fast-twitch athlete with massive amounts of single one-punch knockout power who also has something. He has that Mike Perry-ness to his game, where he's not only good, but he tends to stick to the few things that he is good at. He does not try and do a bunch of silly shit that gets him worked in fights.
He's got good timing, good power, and he just kind of sticks to it. And I'll say, because this is a slight shame fight for me as well, I also he looked on the regional circuit as if he had good takedown defense.
Yeah.
And that's probably one of the biggest narratives going into this fight, is that it was revealed in his UFC debut against Victor Pesta that he didn't really. He had a good sprawl and a good sense of distance with his, you know, boxing ability. But it turns out that the moment somebody actually got in and started working, he did not know how to wrestle in the clinch. He didn't know how to fight for underhooks.
What we call functional first-level takedown defense.
He had 6 months of sprawl training takedown defense. Like, it was not up to par in any kind of chain wrestling scenario. And so I think the biggest narrative for him going into this fight is, can he stop the takedowns? And I posit that that is exactly what made this such an awful fight, because I think Konstantin Arakin, you're about to see the man who's just entered the cage fight as if he is terrified of being taken down.
Yeah, that is definitely a massive part of it. And it's too bad, too, because like I say, I mean, his regional record is about as good as a regional heavyweight record is going to be, you know? Yeah. Like, beating dudes like, I believe he, did he, was it Tim Sylvia, one of the dudes that he beat? Or, I know, because he beat
out Dave Huckaba and Brett Rogers.
Oh, Brett Rogers, that's who it was. Brett Rogers, Dave Huckaba, Sokaju, these guys are not mainstay names at the top level, but in regional MMA, like, you cannot do a lot better than that for a heavyweight.
Yeah, there's not a lot of, I mean, there's not a lot of talent out there. He beat a fairly experienced heavyweight called named Richard Odoms.
Yep.
Who beat like guys like DJ Linderman and stuff like that. So he beat a decent array. But he just really, really fell flat. I mean, the Pesta fight was one thing. This fight, I mean, it's less shameful to lose to Gabriel Gonzaga than it is Victor Pesta, because Pesta's so underdeveloped still. He's so raw. But this is a worse performance for Irokin. Like, Irokin got some things going. He almost knocked Pesta out and then kind of discovered that Pesta is incredibly durable and then started to gas and get out-wrestled. But he was like, in this fight, it's like he knew he gassed and he knew he got taken down. And his solution to avoiding both of those things was just to do nothing.
Yeah, to not so it's like, don't try for fear of failure.
Basically, it's a fight where he fought not to lose. And
also too bad that at 5'11", that he wasn't able to like go down to light heavyweight or something, somewhere where the size differential might not have, you know, might have helped up his takedown defense a little.
Sure. Yeah. He's a pretty heavily built dude, though. I mean, we're getting a look at him right now. He's kind of got that Kelvin Gastelum build, or like that Brian Nelson body. Yes, the Alir Latifi body. Yes. Where it's a wonder that Alir Latifi, like
5'7", 5'6" light heavyweight,
and it's still almost a wonder that he can make the 205 limit.
Yeah. Gonzaga looking very much man, bear, pig, like Gonzaga always does.
I miss the mustache, though.
True.
Round one is about to begin, so we'll time it. We've got the ring girl walking back, Irokin, Gonzaga. I'll do my best Mike Goldberg impression. And
go.
Here we go.
Yeah. I spoiled it. I walked all over it. I'm sorry. This is also kind of the bigger part of this, too, honestly, has to be that this is kind of eventually a shameful indictment of where Gabriel Gonzaga ended up as a heavyweight.
Yeah.
Because you've got a dude who is, I mean, massive amounts of power, very much a one-trick pony, who is terrified of engaging you deliberately, and you can't get anything done with that.
Yeah. Like Gonzaga has had a lot of almost performances. Like, he almost turned in a good showing against Stipe Miocic, who is currently the heavyweight champion.
Yeah.
He almost did. And then I think he broke his hand or something.
Yep.
And spent the rest of the fight looking terrible. And he almost achieved real contender status by knocking out Mirko Krokop. And then I think he was immediately stopped by, did he fight Randy Couture after that?
Was it? That sounds right.
Let's see. He knocked out Krokop, yep, and then immediately got knocked out by Randy Couture, and then Fabricio Verdum. And so, like, every time...
First clear strike just landed at 3 minutes and 45 seconds of round one. So it took a minute and 15 seconds to land the first clear strike of the fight, and it was an inside leg kick.
There's a game you can play with feints, Zane, where you can feint somebody and you can get them to react, and you can capitalize on that reaction, or you can feint them and they don't react, and you can go ahead with what you were feinting. And neither man seems aware of that. Irokin is reacting to every feint by pulling out of range, and Gonzaga seems to have no follow-up in plan for any feint to capitalize on that reaction.
Yeah. The feints are not actually feints. They're just not thrown strikes.
At the very least, Gonzaga is fainting. I will say that. Irokin is doing a lot of waiting. He is really just – he's not trying to
– Here's a philosophical question to interrupt you. is a feint if there's nothing to follow it up? Like, if you don't plan on ever throwing a strike, is a feint a feint?
If the guy keeps buying it, then I say it is. And Gonzaga, okay. He did land something off the feint there. He feinted, Irokin stepped back, and he hit him with a decent body kick. Okay, it was partially blocked, but it was something that mostly landed.
So that's two clean strikes landed in this fight. They're both kicks from Gonzaga. They both happened, or that second one was at about 2.5 minutes into the fight. So we got a minute and 15 seconds, and then 2.5 minutes. So every minute and 15 seconds, Gonzaga is landing a strike.
Takedown attempt there. Tried a head kick off of it.
And we can see.
Did sprawl and stop the takedown.
That's his functional first-level takedown defense is in place.
You can see how seeing that, we were like, this guy can stop a takedown. Fortunately for him, too, Gonzaga is not an amazing chain wrestler.
Yeah. Which then, of course, makes you think, well, you stuffed a takedown. He's not an amazing chain wrestler. Maybe you should actually press the fight a little here.
We got a nice
two punches from Rockin, and those actually look like they hurt Gonzaga.
Yeah, he fainted, threw the counter right, and followed up with a left, and the left landed pretty solidly. Got some knuckles to the temple there. That was actually a good shot.
Yep.
But now
I wonder if that's the strike that broke Arakin's hand, too, or the strikes that broke his hand.
Maybe, yeah. Now Irokin seems bound to follow that up by going back to inactivity. And that's the thing. He's got some momentum. He's got Gonzaga biting. Initiative is like a line with a chart, right? The chart divides the two. Irokin's on top. Gonzaga's on the bottom. Initiative can be pulled one way or the other. But you've got to do something to keep that line on that dot on your side of the line.
So there was another left hook landed by Irokin. Not as clean, but he did land one. And he stuffed a takedown.
Sprawl's looking good.
But it should be noted, to this point in the fight, we have had 4 minutes and 30 seconds in, 5 landed strikes, and 2 failed takedown attempts. That is the entirety of the offense in this fight.
Yep. It doesn't show a lot of signs of changing either. Irokin's back to waiting. And he is a good counterpuncher, but the thing is Gonzaga is
nice now body we have kick. 6 landed strikes. There's another body kick. Sorry.
And reactive takedown from Gonzaga. And this, I think, is what spells doom for the rest of the fight. Because Irokin has 10 seconds left. He's like, all right, I'm going to go after him. He telegraphs a right hand, and that is where that first-level takedown defense fails. He can't scramble. He can't clinch fight, so he gets put in his back.
Yep. But that was an Irokin round, I would say. I don't know. Was it Gonzaga?
You might want to call it a draw round because Gonzaga landed some powerful body kicks. Irokin landed one really solid shot to the head. That was the hardest shot of the round and possibly the most effective, but not a lot happened.
You score a whole round off one hard shot.
Yeah, I would almost call it a draw.
Yeah.
I don't think either guy did much to win the round.
No, not really. It definitely – and yeah, I mean, so Rokin's trying. He's leading a little, trying to – God, if he would just actually throw a jab.
Yeah, it's all pawing, and a paw is useful. He did try to pop out a jab there.
Yeah.
A paw is useful for measuring your distance and maybe for obstructing the other guy's vision, but it doesn't make the other guy jump and react. It's not a feint. And if you're not connecting with their hands, it's not a super effective measurement of distance either. It's kind of just that Anderson Silva mumbo jumbo where you're just, ooh.
Yeah. Nice right overhand from Gonzaga in return of a jab. But that begs a question right there. You've thrown this jab. You finally got the guy to react and throw something to counter, and you didn't counter. Like, what is Irokin's plan behind this jab? Because he's not throwing anything behind it. And if it's to draw Gonzaga into something to strike, to draw Gonzaga into a strike to counter it, then why does he not counter anything?
Mm-hmm. He may have landed it there. Might have caught a forearm, but he is actually throwing the jab. But he's got to follow it.
Preferably
to the body. Wouldn't that be nice? You would dissuade the takedown attempt with a low shot. You would hit an open target because Gonzaga loves that high guard. Something different. Something other than just a right hand left hook to the head.
Yeah. And two, it's just – if you're throwing the jab and the guy's not ducking it, he's not slipping it, he's not getting way out of the way, then that's the time to, like, you've found the opening to follow up. Like, you have something where you say, okay, you're giving me the freedom to build off a jab. Build off the jab. But no, we're watching Irokin bob around, throw and land the occasional jab. And that now, is really...
The roles have reversed, though, I will say that. Now it is just Gonzaga waiting to counter, and Irokin trying to make something happen unsuccessfully.
Yeah. And not really even trying to make something happen, just trying to stay busy.
Staying busy. He's trying to bullshit a little bit. He's making it look like he's busier than he is. But yeah. Gonzaga's not buying it. That's the thing.
Yeah. Because that's what pisses me off about a fight like this is because...
Right hand to the body.
Right to the body. Perfect. Exactly what should be happening.
Irokin has done just enough at every turn, just enough to almost satisfy my complaints.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing. You look at Irokin, you're like, this guy could make something of himself. He could be a good heavyweight.
He's fast. He's light on his feet. He has good hand speed. He has great power. And he sticks to the basics. He sticks to simple stuff he knows how to do.
Yeah, it's just shy of being enough of any of those things all the time.
Yeah. And it's just, like,
good body kick from Gonzaga. Hard whiff from Irokin.
Yeah. Man, it bugs me so much to see fighters not create anything when they have the time and space. Yeah. Like, that's the thing I hate to see. It's just like, what are you doing to functionally try and win this fight at all? You know, I hate that.
How effective is it being? Because if you have an idea in mind, but the other guy isn't biting, it's not working, then you got to have a change of strategy.
Yeah. And it's because I hate that much more than like your dislike of the what's his name? John Dodson style, where it's just like he has no plan, but he's working on stuff all the time. Like, I'm just going to throw a bunch of stuff out there whenever, whatever, see if it happens. Yeah. Like, I can at least, you know, I understand that was also a bad intentions head kick, but no setup whatsoever.
Okay, takedown defense, though.
Yeah, decent. You know, like we say, you look at Gonzaga, or you look at Irokin's first level takedown defense, it's not bad. You actually do have to wrestle him to get him down. Mm-hmm. But, you know, now he's trapped against the fence and not creating anything.
Hard knee, cuffing right hand there. I'm going to go ahead and say, Zane, Irokin won that round.
Yeah,
I think Gonzaga didn't do much of shit. He landed kind of a glancing leg kick or two, one really solid body kick, and not much else. Irokin got off his jab a few times. He landed a hard right hand to the body.
We'd be giving Irokin that round based off the busyness of his jab, basically.
Pretty much, yeah. That a few times it seemed to sneak through Gonzaga's guard.
Yeah.
And a couple, like one power shot to the body and maybe a hook upstairs, if I recall.
And I believe this fight did, in fact, is one of the rare fights that had a 10-10 round scored.
Did it?
Yeah.
See, now that was actually, he almost ran Gonzaga into a body shot there.
Yep.
But then he gets crazy trying to stop the takedown. Like, it looks like there's anxiety there. So he starts swinging nuts, and that is what leads to him being actually out-wrestled in a scramble.
Yeah.
And now we will see the depths of Konstantin Irokin's ground game.
Well, I mean, to his credit, he didn't get submitted by Gabriel Gonzaga, so, you know, that's something, but it's not a lot here. Man, it's just, yeah. You look at a whole round like round two. See, in retrospect to this, you look at a round like round two, and all the time that Irokin had to work in that round and to build. And it's just like, you got so little done with that.
Yeah.
And now you're on your back.
We've got Irokin on his back. He's got a bigger man on top of him and a much better grappler. He's got a half guard, almost a lockdown going, legs laced, but he's completely flat on his back. And I haven't seen him actually execute one hip movement since he got taken down.
No. Although weirdly, Gonzaga really seems dedicated to trying to land TKO ground and pound rather than trying to submit Irokin, who obviously doesn't seem to have much idea of what to do on the ground.
Yeah. He seemed really determined to A, tie up Irokin's left arm, and then B, hit him in the face. I'm not sure what Gonzaga's plan is here.
Yeah, he's and normally when it's somebody tying up the arm like that, I think, oh, he's going for a strongman sub. He's going for a Kimura. But he's not. He was just trying to do it to land an elbow, slashing elbow, and then to turn that into ground and pound. Now he's going for the Kimura.
Going for Kimura here. I think Irokin's got a hold of his shorts.
And I can't, honestly, too, you're looking like you've seen Irokin's arms and musculature. I can't imagine trying to get a strongman sub on that dude. Uh-huh. Like,
I would think you'd maybe want to try and guillotine him in a scramble or something like that.
Or rear naked choke. Like, mount him, make him flip over, and get
him. We're going to do a mount now. We got a three-quarter mount from Gonzaga. Now the strikes make sense because now he might prompt an attempt from Irokin to scramble. Irokin may actually have the right idea not going nuts and trying to escape, but it's not the right idea for the third round of this fight when he hasn't won it, you know?
Yeah.
There we go.
He slides out the back, gives up his back, but Gonzaga can't stay on. Actually fun moment of scrambling.
So again, that may have been the right approach. He didn't go crazy until he really needed to. And now had Gonzaga just hung out in half guard and just chipped away, he could have won the round. So maybe that was Gonzaga's thought as well. Maybe he was thinking, I'm going to ride it out. I think I won the first. And Irokin is thinking, he needs to go for something so I can actually scramble and make one desperate bid to escape.
And the problem here is now clear that Irokin, that huge burst of energy, has left him pretty drained.
He looks tired.
He looks tired. And Gonzaga looks tired.
Yeah.
And Gonzaga...
This is how heavyweight fights end.
Yeah, Gonzaga has built up a strong lead at this point in this round. And the first two rounds sucked. Horribly.
Yeah. Irokin he's tired, and unfortunately what happens, I think, a lot of times when you get fatigued is you're thinking about how tired you are rather than about what you can do to compensate for it. And so he's like, all right, I'm really tired. I can only – basically, his conclusion is I can only land one big power shot. There's no setup, though. He spent all that time working on this jab. He got Gonzaga covering up and everything to respect it. But now
he's not going back to the jab. There's nothing – not building.
Now he's just looking for the lead overhand right.
Oh.
Good counter there. Good counter.
Yeah. There's a nice little uppercut he threw in there. He's kind of white guy tired, too. Which is that specific tired when your whole body turns pink?
Yeah. White guy tired or Asian drunk. The two states that Irokin is in right now. He's got some flush going on. You know, it wasn't as bad as I remembered, Zane.
Dude, there were 6 strikes landed in round one.
I have certain reservations for heavyweight, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it wasn't, I know what you mean.
There were some good flashes. The thing is what Irokin's problem in this fight, because you could clearly see at points, there's some real talent there. Like that, the last 10 seconds, that counter combination, beautiful.
Yeah.
Him, I think with a jab coming in, uppercut as he ducked for the takedown, left hook on the exit, wonderful. Perfectly selected punches. But he needed Gonzaga to come in like an idiot to land those punches. Like he needed somebody who was the kind of guy he fought on the regional circuit, someone who wasn't skilled, who wasn't smart, and he didn't have the tools to make an experienced fighter make those mistakes.
Yeah.
And Gonzaga didn't make enough mistakes to give him those openings.
And it's too bad, especially because he really didn't have to, like, Gonzaga didn't do that much to dissuade Irokin from creating.
No.
You know?
One takedown, and I think that completely shook Irokin and made him really, really cautious for round two.
Yeah.
So Gonzaga wins the decision. It was not a good performance from Gonzaga either.
No. I mean, and you could functionally argue that he lost that fight. Like
you could.
Yeah. That round three, the ground and pound, probably, you know, it swayed it for him, but it was the hardest shot of the fight landed by Irokin with that – like one flurry at the end probably was the hardest shot of round one landed by Irokin. Did Irokin, was he busier in round two? Like,
Yeah, I think they probably – honestly, I would have this fight a draw. Honestly, I would say the first round was a draw. Irokin won the second, and Gonzaga won the third.
Yeah.
And I would say 29-29.
Yeah, I wouldn't argue that heavily, frankly.
Unanimous decision for Gabriel.
It was a unanimous decision. Okay. I know one round of it was scored 10-10, though. So it was like the scores for it were super funky.
But we can look it up on MMA decisions.
Yeah. Let's see.
So let's see. MMA decisions. Gabriel Gonzaga defeats Konstantin Irokin. One of the judges gave round two a 10-10.
Oh.
I think that's one of the least likely for a 10-10, to be quite honest.
Yeah.
Strange. Someone gave all three of the judges gave Gonzaga the first round, which I guess, like, if you're going to give it to someone, I guess that makes sense, but not a lot happened.
No, there were 6 strikes and 2 failed takedown attempts. That was round one.
Yeah. Some of those body kicks were partially blocked. But everyone scored it for Gonzaga. Nobody in the MMA media gave it a draw, so maybe we're crazy.
Yeah.
Shall we queue up GSP versus Jake Shields?
Yeah, I think it's time to get that started. Let me make sure that I have it properly rewound this time. Yep, all right. Okay. I'm at the beginning.
I'm ready, too.
All right, let's dive in, because it's hard to... You know, that is a down note, so it's hard to just keep talking about it because it's kind of...
Let's move on. A fight that actually, at the very least, if it's not good, it did mean something.
So now we're getting to our big, huge fight that just disappoints. We'll be looking at more of these along the way, too. They're a little harder to pick out, honestly, because... Mm-hmm. A lot of fandom pushes sometimes – it sometimes pushes big fights into, like, no, I really enjoyed that because I like X Fighter.
I have never found Evans' Rampage to be terrible. I thought it was okay. It was tense. You know, like, I cared. And so watching it, like, there's tension there. Just like a lot of people, I'm sure, would have been really disappointed by Silva Diaz. But, like, the fight was tense, you know. There was stuff going on. It was a lot slower than it could have been, you know, but – it doesn't necessarily make it a bad fight. The really thing that makes this fight bad, which we will see when we play it, is that it's an uncharacteristically ugly fight from George St. Pierre. You expect maybe a low level of action when George has his way with his opponents. You don't expect him to look like a sloppy fighter. And he really kind of does, if I recall correctly.
All right. So let's kick this off starting in 3, 2, 1, go.
All right, we get a nice fade in from black to the Zuffa text there this time.
Yep. Now the slow motion, dudes waving flags, lady with GSP sign.
Canada, shirtless guys.
Yep.
Look at Jake Shields' face, man. I just can't look at him without smiling. He just looks like, I don't know, man, just like the hard gangster shit that comes out of his like, nice white nerd mouth is so charming to me for some reason.
No, I love it. I remember I did a review of a documentary once on like Latino fighters in MMA, focusing on I think it was Miguel Torres and Gilbert Melendez and maybe Diego Sanchez. It might have been Leonard Garcia. I can't remember who the third one was. But, you know, for Torres and for whoever else it was in there, like, they had, you know, all these, you know, these friends or family or other Latino dude. Oh, it was Cain Velasquez. That's who the third one was. And so even, for, you know, for, like, Cain Velasquez and for Miguel Torres, they all had, like, all these stories about how, you know, their Latino roots and all these people talking for them and talking about them and their connections and community and all that. Mm-hmm. Got to Gilbert Melendez and Jake Shields.
That's his, like, that's his Latino brother is Jake Shields.
Yeah.
Jake Shields. just Jake Shields is such an incongruous part of the scrap pack. He's great.
He is. He is the quintessential. It's the whole, like, the joke about how that white dude that hangs out with black dudes is the craziest white dude.
Dave Chappelle says you worry about, like, you're not scared as a black man. He's not scared of any white people, but he's scared of the white dude who has been accepted into the group of black people because he must be crazier than all of them. That's Jake Shields.
That is absolutely Jake Shields.
Yeah. We should talk about the significance of this fight because it almost seems lost to the ages because Jake Shields' UFC career didn't really pan out the way he wanted it to. He's definitely remembered as a really dull fighter more than as a great fighter, although he is absolutely, in my mind, one of the three best. Well, yeah, but he is absolutely one of the probably top three welterweights of all time. He actually ranks fairly highly as a middleweight, too. He has had a really impressive career. His resume is outstanding. And for this fight, he came in, let's see, having just beaten Dan Henderson, I think. Okay, so he came in having just beaten Dan Henderson to retain his Strikeforce title. That was actually the second title fight. He won the title from Jason Miller back when Mayhem was still doing things.
And God, I remember that fight. That fight was so weird.
Yeah, was Jake Shields' fight.
Yeah.
And then he came into the UFC and he beat Martin Kampman in his welterweight return. And so he basically comes in reigning middleweight Strikeforce champion, just came back to the UFC, returned to welterweight. Let's get him to fight the best welterweight of all time.
Jake Shields looking cut, you know.
Yeah. This is Jake Shields. Like, he was riding a huge win streak here. He had beaten not just Kampman, Henderson, Miller. He beat Robbie Lawler. He beat Paul Daly. He beat Mike Pyle. He beat a lot of really solid guys. Yushin Okami and Carlos Condit before that. Dave Mene, Toby Amato. These are all guys in like a – let me count these here. A 15-fight win streak coming into this fight.
Yeah. So, now Shields is legit. It's one of those more greater than the sum of its parts. Or like maybe it's actually less than the sum of its parts. Maybe it actually is what it is. Where like any way you look at Shields' record on paper, it is hyper impressive.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of things about his technical ability that are very impressive and very good. And yet the experience of watching an entire Jake Shields fight is rarely overwhelming. Like you're rarely like, oh my God, did you see that shit he did? That was
often the most impressive thing Jake Shields does is come back from being hurt in some way or walk through a hailstorm of punches. His toughness is often the only thing that on this, like to a lay fan, couldn't really impress anyone. And then the way that he chooses to win after surviving usually turns most people off.
Yeah. Man, I remember him getting nearly killed by Dan Henderson.
Right. And that's an amazing example. He came back, like, to come back from that, that is incredibly impressive. And he dominated Dan Henderson on the ground after that.
Yeah.
But he dominated Dan Henderson in a way that after a round of it, people are probably like, I don't want him to win this fight with three more rounds of this. I don't want to see this anymore.
So, I forgot. Let's see. Which is – this is UFC 129. This is like one of the major flagship GSP gates and deliveries in terms of
– oh, yeah.
Like bringing in fans, right? Like I can't remember what's the huge like their biggest outside Nevada gate thing that was like.
I don't know. This one was in Toronto. He rematched Josh Koscheck in Montreal. That may have been it.
Let me see.
Maybe largest the Matt Serra rematch.
UFC gate. Let's see. UFC
GSP draws a crowd.
No, UFC 129.
So there you go. Yeah.
It was the largest event in North American history. This is the one that had 55,000 fans at it.
That's what I was just saying. I don't know whatever arena this is, but it is absolutely packed.
It's the Rogers Center. Yeah.
Tons of people here to see George fight.
And that exceeding 11 million as a gate. Shattering both MMA attendance and gate records in North America.
Wow.
So
it's an impressive crowd to be sure.
That makes it all the more disappointing to know surrounding what a big fucking deal this was. Like, people may remember, like, they look back now, like, really, was GSP Shields that big a deal? I mean, you know, I don't think that much. Jake Shields, like, who would have been excited about that?
Yeah, like, based on current, that's what I was saying before, based on current relevance, we remember, we're like, oh, the Nick Diaz fight, the Carlos Condit fight, maybe, like, the Thiago Alves or the BJ Penn fights. We don't remember his fight with Jake Shields being amazing, and I think that's partly because people don't like Jake Shields, and partly because the fight wasn't good. Yeah. Even by GSP standards, it was not an accessible fight.
No, it was an ugly fight, but it's amazing to think of, like, just how much pomp there was around it. It would be like,
it's the last time anyone's ever been that excited for a Jake Shields fight.
You know, it would be like rolling, you know, you're talking about the sort of the same sort of circumstances like the UFC 189 when they had like the platforms and like the live singers and all that. Like, you're talking about that level of drive from the UFC to make this a big event.
Mm-hmm.
And if you put this fight on the top of that UFC 189, if like Conor McGregor delivered this fight, it would be a memorable flop.
What a fucking team in the corner, by the way. John Danaher, Firas Zahabi, Phil Nurse, and Greg Jackson all there to corner GSP.
Yeah.
That is crazy.
Like, that really makes you put in perspective just how big a deal GSP was at the prime of his reign. It's like, you're looking at, like, who else has that kind of coaching staff in the corner ever? Or ever has.
Yeah, that level of like celebrity coaches.
Yeah.
Yeah, no one that I can think of.
Think of it at all. It's a pretty insane lineup, and it's a good reminder too of just how big a deal GSP was at the time.
Mm-hmm. Like, he deserved it, man. Like, his, like I said, Jake Shields' resume is incredible. GSP's is the only resume that is head and shoulders better.
Yeah.
In this division. It's the only one. GSP's resume stands alone as a GOAT resume in the MMA welterweight division.
Well, it's one of those rare resumes, too, that not only did he beat the guys that came before him.
Right.
You know, he beat the Matt Hughes. He beat Matt Hughes. He beat Frank Trigg. Some of those other, like, the fighters that were notable before GSP.
Sean Sherk.
Those guys. Then he beat all the dudes in his era. He beat all the best fighters that were there, the contenders of his time, John Fitch, Carlos Condit, Jake Shields, all those dudes. And I realize it's arguable, then he went out and he beat the future contender. He beat the next guy to be champ. He beat Johnny Hendricks.
Yeah.
Like,
he's the only guy I can think of who successfully defeated three generations of contenders.
Exactly. Like, most other fighters, you get somebody like Jose Aldo. Jose Aldo, he came out, he beat Mike Brown, he beat Uriah Faber, he beat the classic dudes that were there before he got there, then he beat all his challengers, and then he fought Conor McGregor. And that was the next generation.
Anderson Silva beats the old guard, he beats all of his guys, and then he loses to the Chris Weidman.
Yep.
It's not just about retiring in a loss. It's just about being able to contend. Like, when you are past your peak and the new guys are coming in, and these are the guys who are like, these are new contenders. They started fighting after your career began, and they're here to take the title. You can beat some of those guys. Even just one of them, he's the only guy I can think of to do it. Fedor, Aldo, you know, Jones, maybe, if he can ever get his shit together.
Yeah, Jones is in the middle. He's beating all of – he beat all the old guard. He beat an amazing amount of old guard.
Yeah. And someday maybe Jones will be, like, stopping the advance of guys like, I don't know, Corey Anderson or someone who will have turned into a contender by then. But for the time being, he has yet to reach that third echelon.
Yeah. Other than that, like, that it is really just a – it's an amazingly difficult – platform to attain.
Yeah. Being a dominant champion in general, I think it's one of the hardest things in any sport. Being a dominant champion in a combat sport. Both guys bow to each other, Zane. We've got respectful martial artists here. It can sell if you do it right. Everybody loves GSP. Even people that hate watching GSP's fights would never go up to GSP and not enjoy his company. He's a very likable person.
He is. How do you hate somebody that had like who went out in an interview and said, my three favorite things are a beautiful woman, dinosaurs, and the violence of the octagon.
Fight begins, by the way, right now. It's GSP. So this is the reason this fight is very weird, if I remember, and we'll see if it plays out the way I remember, because we've had two that kind of defied my memory. What I remember is that this is kind of post-GSP jab. He developed that jab to take Josh Koscheck apart. That was when it really – he unveiled it. Just like Aldo really unveiled his jab to take apart Frankie Edgar. It was when he really started to rely on it. In this fight, he decided he wanted to have an overhand right too. And so I remember a lot of really sloppy Chuck Liddell-esque right hands, as if somebody told GSP he needed to knock Jake Shields out and that was the way to do it. So far, we have some nice educated work from the lead side of GSP's body. We have some nice kicks. Yep. With some nice jabs.
Shields going for a low single, which he's never going to get in his entire life on George St. Pierre.
Yep.
Shields is many things, but a power takedown artist is not one of them.
No.
Yeah, and it's...
These Jake Shields knees, man.
That's one of the things, I guess.
Has there ever been less impetus in a strike?
I can't imagine actually, in retrospect, approaching a Jake Shields fight and thinking, I need to knock this dude out.
Because that's the last thing you want to do, you think, right?
Because it is basically undoable. Like, Jake Shields, you can't knock Jake Shields out. You take the Hector Lombard approach. You go beast mode on Jake Shields. Even Tyron Woodley, even the current welterweight champion, he would lost to Jake Shields.
Yeah, I was going to say he would have a hard time knocking Jake Shields out. He failed. He already failed. So did Robbie Lawler, the other guy to win the title as a knockout artist. Nobody knocks out Jake Shields, not even Dan fucking Henderson, who almost won the middleweight title at 46 years old. So, yeah, it's a bad idea. So far, there is none of that. We have some nice fencing going on with the jabs. Beautiful counter jab there from George to an inside leg kick.
There's your first weird winging right hand.
George has always had a bizarre right hand. I think because he puts a lot of weight into that jab, he gets like a hard drop step behind that jab. And then his legs are so far apart and his weight's already forward, he can't do anything for the right hand but lean into it. And so there's never been a lot of power in it. Even in the John Fitch fight when he was knocking Fitch down with it, there's never been a ton of power in that shot.
I have questions, honest questions, about how much karate there ever is in the late GSP style.
There was a decent right hand there.
There's a decent one. But I definitely, like, that's where I think you see it, is, like, the sort of... He never has the karate blitz, but it's, like, that's still kind of how he knows to throw that right hand, is in that, like...
Yeah, and even then, I much prefer, like, the left hand of a Lyoto Machida to GSP's. It's got a lot more base in it. I think it's just because once he developed that jab, the way he learned to throw it, it's not the kind of jab. Oof.
Yeah.
Hell of a jab there, timed for Shields' kick. There's just the way he throws it, all the ability to put power in a punch goes into that jab. And there's just no mechanical force left for the right hand. You'd have to reset. And when he wants to throw the right hand, he's almost always throwing it behind the jab, which is why the one where I said that's a good right hand a minute ago, it was a lead right. He can throw a good lead right, but he can't throw a good 1-2.
Oh, Jake Shields just missed on 5 arm punches.
GSP is pressuring. This has not been too bad so far, Zane. This has actually been kind of vintage GSP.
Yeah, this is very much vintage GSP. I think the problem is that it's vintage GSP, but it's still going to be a Jake Shields kickboxing match.
Yes, and also Shields does start poking GSP in the eye.
We can see he's starting to jab with his fingers out, with his hands open.
I think he is actively looking for it.
Wouldn't surprise me at all.
He is actually, like, he's trying to rake past GSP's eye. He's got his fingers open, and he's not pawing. He's actually throwing the hand as if it were a closed fist.
Exactly, with the hand open.
I think he's trying to poke George in the eye.
It's not even the John Jones, let me put my hand on your face eye rake.
It's a finger jab.
It's a jab with his hands open.
Ooh. See, like right there, we got an overhand, but it doesn't have power on it. All the weight's already forward. It's just, he's already committed because he set it up with the jab.
Yep. So a clear, easy GSP round, and still a kickboxing round with Jake Shields.
Yeah, it wasn't bad, though. I actually enjoyed, I've always enjoyed watching GSP dominate somebody. That was no exception. That was good.
Very, very easy and clear. I can't even remember, I cannot actually remember a single strike that Jake Shields landed in that round.
He landed a leg kick when GSP was trying some Sanchai-style footwork, getting flashy in front of him, and he landed a leg kick that did nothing. And he landed about three knees in that clinch at the beginning of the round.
Oh, that's right, the knees.
They touched GSP's body. I'm not sure how much penetrative force there was behind him. So here we see, look, there's that right hand. See how his weight's committed? His right foot is off the ground. Even if it's a fully, all the weight that's left in it, there's just no torque. His weight isn't sinking down anymore. He's overcommitted when he throws that 1-2.
Yeah, the interesting thing really is for somebody who's explosive and is good at closing distance dynamically as GSP is, he doesn't actually, when he throws his right hand, he doesn't close the distance effectively to do it. He's not actually bringing himself in and planting. He's bringing his front foot forward and planting on that instead of bringing his whole body in.
Rory McDonald has the same issue. I think it's something to do with the way Firas Zahabi teaches footwork. His fighters tend to be committed very heavily to their front foot already. And you can drop step into a good straight shot that way, but at a certain point of extension, you need to have some weight pulled back in order to put it forward. The guys with the best right hands tend to be you watch Dan Henderson fight, even he doesn't fight fully loaded on his back foot, but he's kind of crouching back over that hip. He's got some weight back there that he can throw into it. If you look at GSP here, his right foot is way out past his butt. It's not under his body.
You could practically lift GSP's back leg off the ground and he would still be fighting the exact same way.
Yes, right, exactly. He's very heavy on that front leg and leaned over it too. So the jab is really the best you can do from that position. Finger jabs.
Yep.
GSP evading them very well so far. And Shields is actually getting off of some kicks in this round.
Yeah.
And GSP is – but the thing is GSP gets off of the kick and it lands way harder. But there's the GSP overhand.
Yeah.
Just saw it reveal itself there. It's not a pretty punch.
No. No, it's really not.
It looks very unnatural. It's like you take – you take all the things that I just said about a right hand, and then you tell the guy who's already functionally incapable. That one was nice, but Shields was in range that time. He was really close.
That time he didn't actually have to step way over because Shields was already inside trying to throw.
So you tell the guy who has a lot of difficulty already throwing a right hand, and then you say, all right, throw the kind that people throw when they really want to throw hard. And it's obvious when GSP throws it.
And it really is. He staggered Shields, but like we said, trying to knock Shields out is just about the worst way to try to fight Jake Shields.
It's terrible. And it's a shame because nothing GSP does is ever very obvious. Most of everything he does is very well set up and very calculated. And this right hand is it's just not good to look at.
No. It's...
This is the round where he is starting to really invest in
it. I think the first actual eye poke. Shields just flicked out a jab with his fingers open.
Really nice spinning back kick from GSP there.
Yeah. That's the first jab that actually just looks like it brushed GSP's eyes.
And I think, judging by that exchange... Oh, that right hand. Who told him to do that? Whose idea? It's not even it's not a good right hand. It seems, judging from the clinch exchange, that GSP came into this fight not even wanting to tangle with Jake Shields on the ground. And so that, again, I think it kind of – his game is already a little limited. GSP's always been a great transitional fighter.
Yeah.
Just choosing to kickbox. And then – he has, for some reason, elected to not really restrict himself to what he's best at with his kickboxing.
Which it's weird because, like I say, I mean, kind of even with the scrap pack in general, one of the ways you kind of have to be able to beat them often. I mean, obviously, GSP can just beat Jake Shields because he goes like this when he wants to throw strikes. Yeah. You see, like, what Jake Shields got caught off guard with. He's on one foot with, like, both hands up in the air getting clipped with an overhand. But, like, you even with the Diaz brothers, one of the ways that you often see fighters beat the scrap pack is just out-wrestling them.
Yeah.
Like, just take them down and be the more physical guy, stay on top, stay safe, and outwork them.
But that's why Jake Shields is the weird member of the scrap pack. He's not good on the feet, unlike all the others. And his ground game is very different from all the others. He's a lot more smothering, a lot more based on getting top position and exhausting you on the ground.
It is, but I still, like, I don't know. I guess he did beat Damian Maia that way too, so.
Yeah, like, it's hard to say you should go into a fight. Like, I don't think it's necessarily a bad idea for GSP to go into a fight with Jake Shields and say, I'm not going to grapple with him if I can avoid it. But that is one explanation why it's so ugly, because it's not what GSP does best.
Yeah.
Strategically, though, I do think it makes sense.
It does.
Things are a little nippier in that round. It's definitely a GSP round, but, like, Shields has now learned that GSP isn't knocking him out with these jabs, so he's just kind of throwing kicks at the same time, accepting the fact that he's going to get hit and landing something anyway. And so it's already getting a little ugly, where GSP is getting caught with things while he's throwing. It's kind of turning into what we saw in, like, the Walsh-Kelly fight.
Yeah, the much better version of that.
Yeah. Where, like, no matter what's happening, both guys are throwing and then backing off, and then both guys are throwing and then backing off.
Yeah, it is a higher level of that, and it's weird to think of for a GSP fight to see him just, like, getting into these, even winning them, getting into these very, like, consistent 50-50 exchanges with Jake Shields where neither guy is hurting each other. He's just landing the better shots.
So Shields starts the round coming forward, just pumping this pathetic jab. GSP runs him into the hardest jab in the division. But still, like, this is the thing. Oh, my God. The footwork of Jake Shields. But he just keeps coming forward. Like, he doesn't really mind.
He looks like he's wearing secret roller skates. Like, Heelys. Looks like he's wearing Heelys. And he only activates one at a time. So he's just kind of, like, slightly suddenly skating. And then stop.
One of his feet is just not where he wants it to be at any given moment. It's unexpectedly moving. It does look like Jake Shields is not in control. It's like Jake Shields is not in control of his whole body at any given moment. Like, if he wants to punch, he can't decide what his feet are going to do. And if he wants to advance, he can't decide what his hands are going to do.
Like, there are literally multiple moments where Jake Shields looks like he has both arms out and one leg off the ground when GSP is coming in to punch him.
It is strange, man.
It really is.
A little bit of work here, though. Jake Shields using his jab, landed an inside leg kick. Nothing has power, but Jake Shields, the right hand. So I guess he wants it because he thinks it's a good counter to the left leg kick, which makes sense. But you'd think GSP would straighten it up a little bit.
Right? Yeah.
Something.
Just a straight 1-2 would even just...
Yeah, like, just a straight right hand would be a great counter to that. Throw out a lead right. Every time, it's this winging overhand.
We saw another couple of eye pokes from Shields.
Yeah, he's definitely going for it there.
He is. Like, that jab, I mean, it's flashing out there a lot. It doesn't have any power on it, but the hands are almost always open.
Yeah.
Oh, now to think, too, of his fight with Husamar Paulharas. Oh. Like... Man, Shields and Paulharas may have deserved each other just a little bit.
Look at that, though, man. That's a very uncharacteristically wild punch for
GSP. It is.
It's full straight arm overhand swing. He's getting his own feet well out of position. He's off balance. Shields, I'll tell you what, man. Much like Kelly in the Kelly Walsh fight, Shields is okay when he doesn't try to even hit you with anything.
Yeah.
It's kind of frustrating because he can only arm punch. So he just keeps the arm punches coming when you're trying to get some work done. Other guys are going to try to hit you hard and give you little moments where they're tensing up, where you can get in your own work. But Shields is just like, it's just bap, 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 constantly just touching you with that left hand.
Yep.
It looks very annoying.
He has no set rhythm, and he's got a constant work rate. I mean, like I say, he beat Tyron Woodley doing that.
Yep.
Tyron Woodley just sat there waiting to try and find those big punches to throw. In the meantime, Shields was just like, bat, 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 bat. Stole a fight.
Yep.
And I mean,
this is one of the closer GSP fights. Like, Shields is actually landing constantly.
He is. He's landing a lot. He's got the, you know, he's keeping the hands open to really dissuade GSP from trying to just exchange too much with him, too.
He went for that full-on John Jones open-fingered block there. He is, he has no qualms about letting George run in. Oh, there we go. I'm not sure what that was, but it looked like an eye rake to me, Zane. I don't know about you. He just reached out and gently cupped the side of GSP's face, hoping that his eyes would catch on the ends of his fingers.
He did. Shields did land a couple nice body kicks in there too, though. Yeah. In the midst of all that work, like that's the thing is like, I've noticed this more and more. Like, especially bad strikers in extended kickboxing fights or in extended MMA kickboxing fights, they tend to foul a lot.
Sure.
And part of that is they get desperate and they get overwhelmed. And when they get overwhelmed, when people get frustrated and desperate and overwhelmed, they just they become kind of awful.
But they can throw a kink into the rhythm of a much better fighter. Like,
yeah.
If you've ever played a fighting game, like play Tekken and go online, and somebody who is just clearly mashing buttons can really ruin your day because you're expecting the patterns of a practiced fighter.
Yeah. And Shields, like, that's kind of what you see out of this a lot to me. And see, this is why I'm like, why don't you just wrestle more, GSP? Like,
but I think he tactically did it in the last 30 seconds.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I would not put it past Jake Shields to find some kind of opening in the jiu-jitsu of GSP and sweep him and win a round if GSP started the round trying to take him down. I don't think it's a bad strategy. I just think the tactics that made up the let's kickbox with him part of the strategy are a little baffling.
So that was an exceptionally ugly round and not a good one for GSP at all.
No, he's definitely complaining about his eye in the corner. He definitely got poked a lot.
Yeah.
Pouring water in his eye.
Definitely got poked. And honestly, like, Shields hit him with a lot of jabs. And even on the ground there, when he got that takedown, Shields was the one landing all the strikes off his back.
Let's point out, though, that GSP is a man who famously wears damage. And even after a round where Jake Shields got a lot more done than he should have, he bears almost no mark on his face.
It's true.
It's so strange. Look, he's not even closing his fist when he jabs.
No, not at all. You can see, like, he threw out one there and he just... It's about as blatant an actual, like, purposeful eye poke as you can get done consistently and not called at any point. Like, not...
Yeah, even when he connects with his knuckles, the fist is not clenched. You can see the thumb is out, the hand is not tightened. There is no effort even. Like, Jake Shields has smartly gotten to the point where he's not trying to hit you hard because he can't. So he just constantly hits you. He's coming out again. He's starting every round pretty aggressively. He actually landed a couple of little baps there. GSP starts the round with an early takedown.
Yeah.
Into butterfly guard. And lands a good shot and backs off.
It's not a bad strategy, I think.
Yeah, like, I think it makes maybe a rinse and repeat, hit him and then get away. It might actually be a good way to go.
That would be the way, because Shields is not any kind of electric, I'm going to snatch a submission out of nowhere grappler.
No. He's got to suffocate you first.
Yeah, it's not Godofredo Pepe out there where you're like, I shouldn't actually touch this guy on the ground because if I do, he might break one of my arms.
Yeah, that's true. The trick is just not to, like, take him down in open space and don't engage for long periods of time.
Yeah. So, yeah, I'm not willing to say that GSP has lost any one of the first three rounds, but Definitely. That last round was probably really close to an even round. Like,
It's the quality of GSP's punches that are winning in the rounds.
That overhand was just so bad, though.
Tragically ugly overhand. But the jab that preceded it, again, definitely the crispest kind of punch either of these guys are landing. Body jab. Now he's going to go for the overhand. Look, body jab to overhand. Classic setup. Oh, he went for Superman jab instead. But it was to the body. I guarantee you he's going to try to set up the overhand with that left hand to the body. He's going to feint low and wing a horrible right hand over the top.
It's like he's trying to pick a plate up off the top shelf of his kitchen. Like,
there it is. Body jab, worst overhand you've ever seen.
There was actually a straight right.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's worth commenting on in this fight.
Yeah, an actual straight right, but he still threw it from his hip. Like, he torqued it like he didn't want to throw it. Like, that was a frustration straight punch. He was just like, dude, back the fuck off.
Here's a straight right. Back to your body jabs. Ooh, head kick knockdown from GSP.
Yeah.
Off the body jab. I love that setup. Rashid Magomedov did that to Elias Silverio, and it was equally beautiful. Body jab, and then brought the leg up when the guy dropped his hand to parry the left.
Another takedown attempt that, like, watching Jake Shields look for a takedown attempt on GSP with, like, a single leg, it's just like, man, there is no way.
It was similar in the Tyron Woodley fight, too. He clinched Woodley a lot, but he couldn't get him down for the life of him.
No.
So that right there easily cements this round as a strong one for GSP because he hit him pretty hard with that lead head kick.
Yeah. And it was a nice left hook from GSP. God, it'd be nice to see more of that. If you plant all your power on your front leg.
Yeah. But again, I don't think he's very comfortable ripping it back. Like, I'm not sure he's – so maybe to give GSP and Zahabi and Jackson all them a little credit – maybe the idea was to get Shields worrying about this really obvious right hand and then use that to set up the hook and the jab and the kicks.
Yeah.
Maybe because it is a very – oh, Jake Shields is
– Jake Shields – yeah, he's trying to egg Shield. He's trying to egg GSP on as though Shields' best chance in this fight is countering or any extended exchange in any way. Like –
he pulled the blood out of his mouth and tried to wipe it on his face. That's what Jake Shields did just then. And somehow this, I think, has actually made him less effective.
It has. Like, there's no amount of Jake Shields, a busier striking Jake Shields who's trying to brawl, is not a better Jake Shields.
You would think being Jake Shields, his strategy would have literally just been to run into the clinch over and over and over and try to exhaust GSP. But even then, he did try early on. I think that was the idea behind those bum rushes, and GSP's footwork was too good.
Yeah, and then you get the Healy factor, where him rushing in is just suddenly like he's just zipping past on a skate, and you're like, where the hell are you going, dude?
Yeah. Now GSP is wearing some facial damage, but this was a stronger round than round three. And there's a head kick again. I love that, man. That's a very quick little switch kick. Very little, like, upper body movement to telegraph it.
Yeah, Shields has stayed busy, but in general, GSP has definitely landed enough big strikes this round to make it very clean and clear.
Mm-hmm. I think it's when GSP starts using two really solid jabs there. I think it's when George starts using a lot of head movement to evade the jab that Shields feels like he has license to poke him. Like, he sees him moving his head and slipping to the inside, and so then he just kind of slaps and tries to rake his eyes a little bit. I think that's when he thinks he can get away with it.
Yeah, he can't.
I don't think he's been talked to once in this fight.
No. Or if he is, like I said, I have the sound off, but he's certainly never been obvious. I mean, at this point, it should be a point. Like, he should have a point taken if you're going to keep your hands open all the time while you're throwing jabs.
Yeah, absolutely.
My dog is doing what's called reverse sneezing right now.
I have a dog who does that.
So she's making a whole bunch of noise. She just woke up and is looking super pathetic about it.
That head kick is really pretty, man.
It is.
He gets his hand down because he was throwing all body jabs before that. Gets his hand to drop, gets him standing up tall. And then GSP has really impressive leg dexterity. Gets that left leg up while he's focused on where the left hand is going. Shields is fired up.
He's so crazy. And yeah, I mean, it's right back. I mean, it's very much been the same. Like, I really wish we'd seen more of the rinse repeat wrestling from GSP, because it seems like so reasonably effective for him. And it's something that, like, in these prolonged exchanges where he's winning, but Shields is still poking him a lot, landing a lot, in there a lot, it would have been really nice to see GSP just take him down another couple times, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, why settle for working exclusively behind, like, working your jab? Oh, God, that right hand.
Worst right hand so far. Really obvious, really terrible.
Yeah, like, again, why settle for purely that kind of fight when you can do more?
Yeah. Yeah, I kind of see what you mean. I think, you know, GSP said that he liked to break his opponents where he was strongest, and then he liked to break them where they were strongest. And this is one of the few fights I can think of where he did not do that.
Yeah.
He comes in here, he outstrikes Jake Shields, but he doesn't then go, all right, I beat you where you're weakest. Now, like, he didn't break Jake Shields' confidence at any point in this fight. As difficult as that may be to do anyway, he's not doing anything to now say, look, I can beat you here too. There's no statement made by GSP in this fight.
Yeah, it really isn't at all. All he's shown is that he can let Jake Shields hang out with him for 5 rounds in a kickboxing match.
Sure, yeah.
Like, that is the overwhelming statement of this fight, is not GSP's dominance or anything good about Jake Shields. It's just that given 5 rounds, GSP is not going to do a whole hell of a lot in a kickboxing match with Jake Shields. Like, you know, he's had a couple nice moments, but not like Jake Shields is hurt or significantly worried about exchanging with GSP at this point.
No.
Oh, man.
I wasn't sure if you were laughing at your dog's noises or Jake Shields' attempt at a head kick.
And that GSP overhand that he just once again, like, oh, let me reach this cup from up here. It's
very bizarre, man. It is really strange. It's always bugged me that he came into the fight seemingly with that in his back pocket. Like, a friend of mine and I have joked for years about how GSP brought in Chuck Liddell as his head trainer for this training camp, and how, like, he'd just been told over and over. Dan Henderson told him, no, you can knock him out. All you got to do is hit him with one more overhand right than I did. Like, it's such a strange choice.
It really is.
And Shields is landing some crisp punches in this round. GSP always seems to find the better one. And maybe it's because Shields is always in a worse position to receive a punch than GSP. So when he gets hit, he does this inflatable, wacky, flailing arm man move where GSP is always solid and stable.
Yeah.
But Shields is still marking up GSP's face. He's still flicking his hands out there. He is still getting work done in the fifth round. He does not look discouraged in any way.
No, and that's what I mean. It's just like kickboxing with Jake Shields, it really...
It's a harder game than it seems.
It is a much harder game than it seems, because he's not going to go away. He's not going to get hurt. He's always going to have this awkward... You know what it really reminds me of? He's much more functional at it because he's just faster on his feet, frankly. But Kaito Nakamura.
Sure, like, yeah.
Super similar.
Absolutely. Like,
he's much busier and much faster on his feet than Nakamura, but it's that same style of just this constant worrying, busy, broken rhythm offense, none of which seems to have a lot of snap behind it, but it will just constantly throw you off the whole way through.
He almost fell over throwing a right hand, Zane. He almost fell over just trying to throw a right hand. Jake Shields, how has he not learned to be better than this, though? Like, after all those platitudes about how really he's the hidden greatness of Jake Shields, how has he spent this long fighting and he still doesn't seem to know how to throw a punch?
No, he doesn't have to know. He still wins.
I guess you're right. I guess that's it. Like, he has a style that works for him. And really nice takedown defense.
Yeah,
there.
He did a good job stuffing that shot from GSP.
Where is that kind of explosive movement when he's striking, though? You give Jake Shields a wrestling exchange, and he's like, he's quick, he's reactive, His hips move instinctively. You give him a boxing exchange and everything is so bizarre, so awkward.
Yeah, I think part of it is just that the lack of quick twitch muscle and the ability for, like, it's a lot easier for some people to have a more natural feel and fluidity to their motion when they're connected to somebody else. Like, when they have that ability to actually have their body connected to somebody, it's a lot easier for them to be coordinated and to know exactly what movements they need to make and how and when. Whereas when you have open space to fill, a lot of people are like, have a lot more trouble finding fluidity when it's just, I'm going to throw a limb out there into open space and see what happens as a result. So,
St. Pierre received a 60-day medical suspension following this fight due to damage to the left eye.
Yeah, it's not a surprise. Like, you see right there, when he got hit by that head kick, that jab he threw was just...
It was designed for an eye poke.
Yep.
And apparently, I'm not listening to audio here, but they ask him about fighting Silva. Remember when that was a pipe dream for us fight fans? White had apparently talked about it. I'm looking at Wikipedia here, but he'd apparently talked about if he won this fight, he beat the middleweight Strikeforce champion, then he could go on to fight the UFC middleweight champion, Anderson Silva. And they asked him, they asked GSP about it in the post-fight interview, and he just says he doesn't want to. So what can you do?
That whole battle, that whole thing was just weird. Partially, yeah, I don't think GSP ever really had much desire to fight Anderson Silva at all. And partially, too, I think it's just this was maybe like the height of the Joe Silva power dynamic era of UFC matchmaking, where he not only really knew what he was doing, but he had really good control over all the fights getting made. And I don't think Joe Silva has ever had any interest, at least from what I've seen. It's hard to know because he's not the kind of dude that does a lot of interviews. But I don't think he's ever had any interest at all in putting on champion versus champion super fights or letting people jump divisions at all.
Sure.
Like, I think that's just one of those things where he's been like, no, I'm putting you in a division. I want this division to be a whole entity. Do not fuck it up.
Two judges just now, Zane, gave two rounds to Jake Shields. This was a 50-45 and then 248-47 card decision. I don't think I would give any round to Jake Shields.
No, not. I would say Jake Shields in round five and in round three, those were very close rounds.
He made GSP look bad, but he didn't outstrike or outfight GSP.
No, he never hurt GSP with any strike that wasn't an eye poke. And he never at any point had any control over this fight in any way.
Props to GSP, by the way, for going through this whole fight getting poked in the eye. He never really seemed to show it in the fight, only in the corner.
Yeah. He didn't complain about it. He never asked the judge to look. He never asked the ref, like, oh, I'm getting poked in the eye. Didn't do that head turn, grab my face thing that, like, I get why people do it. I get that they maybe should do it because refs aren't going to call shit unless you make them. But it's always funny, interesting to me to see, like, you go back to the old events of the UFC when it was as close to no rules as they could make it. You never see anybody like, oh my God, I got hit in the groin. Don't, you know, like, stop the fight. Don't let him hit me anymore. You never see anybody going, oh my God, I got hit in the eye. Stop the fight. I can't go. Everybody just was like, shit, this is a fight. I got to fight through it. I'll tough it out. And then once those things became illegal, suddenly everybody's grabbing their crotch. Everybody's grabbing their eyes. Everybody is, you know, making sure that the foul is seen and called. And it should be. They should be called. But it does bring up some of the idea of, like, just how performative some of the, oh my God, I got poked in the eye, why aren't we must stop the fight aspect of it is.
Yeah. So, Zane, now that we've watched all three of our fights, let's go ahead and rate them. Which ones are worth watching again, or which ones do you least regret rewatching? And in what way did any of them defy your expectations?
Shields GSP is the one I least regret watching because I always enjoy watching GSP. Like, even a bad performance, I'm interested to see what he does.
Sure, yeah.
Other than that, Walsh versus Kelly, it's still just as – it's maybe more forgettable than I initially remembered it being. Like, I think on the night, I remembered it being this horrible, sloppy –
It was a good night for MMA Twitter in particular. People were cracking a lot of jokes. For the MMA community, that was a great fight to experience live.
Yeah, and in replay, it's just more forgettable.
Yeah.
I think, but more than it is bad, it's just there.
Yeah, it's the essence of mediocrity. Still, would you say that it ranks above Gonzaga Irokin?
Oh, of course. That fight's still a shitty tire fire.
Yeah. I think I have to agree with you all the way. I think GSP Shields, there was certainly enough action that actually it was pretty engaging to watch. There was constantly something happening. And when Jake Shields doesn't have his way with his opponent, the fights are usually pretty fun because you get to see how tough Jake Shields is and how game he is. You get to enjoy the weirdness of his striking style. And he didn't have his way with GSP, nor did GSP really have his way with Jake Shields the way he might have wanted to. So it was actually kind of a back and forth fight, one which, again, I think I would give every single round of to George St. Pierre.
Yeah.
And Walsh Kelly, I don't know it. I was partway through, I was starting to think this is better than I remember because I saw gears turning in Daniel Kelly's head and then it stopped working. And the third round was awful. So I think I'm going to reinstate your description of two guys being pushed together on the ends of shopping carts. I think it ended up being that fight in my mind.
Well, it still is very much like you have two people here and they go, ah, ah, ah. Like that is still very much that fight. Like,
yeah. Yeah. The only difference is that it looked more than I remember. It was like Walsh, his arms were like also tied to broomsticks. He couldn't bend them or like pull back for a punch. So it's just this, he was like that. And then Daniel Kelly was throwing straight punches, but he was like the guy in the Just Bleed Fans GIF where it was just like no body movement. Just
he was in Ronda Rousey beach training video.
Yeah. No body movement, no hip engagement whatsoever, just straight punches. And so there's not a ton of praise to be heaped on either man for that fight. At the very least, Daniel Kelly has redeemed himself.
Yeah.
And he showed a twinkling in that fight of the skills that would allow him to beat better fighters than Patrick Walsh. So
I still might have scored the fight against him, but
yeah, it wasn't a great showing, but there were little suggestions of actual talent there and skill. And Irokin Gonzaga it's just a frustrating fight. I think that's the worst thing you can have is a fight where it's like there could be something happening. Clearly, you have the ability to do this, and it just never occurs. So
yeah, because Irokin, like watching it again, like I still see all the same reasons that I think of him as a great prospect.
Yeah, more than I did at the time. At the time, I was just disappointed. But watching it now, I was like, Irokin, every time he does something, it reminds me why I thought he was a good fighter. It's just that him doing something is so few and far between.
Definitely. Well, on that note, I think we've significantly depressed ourselves, which is the point of this.
The MMA depressed us today, Zane.
Yes. So we'll be back next time. We might be back next week, maybe. If I'm in town, yeah, I'll be in town. We might be back next week for another one of these.
There's no card again. Why not?
Yep. So we'll be back next week for another three fights. Once again, we'll be doing one bad, boring fight, one bad, sloppy fight, and one bad, major disappointment.
So basically a fight that is sloppy and enjoyable, but you could never say that it means anything or that it was really good.
Yep.
One that is a true torture to watch, and then one that it turns out that after the fact that it had been overhyped. It didn't deserve the amount of excitement that it conjured on a widespread basis. So,
and which usually means it includes some very big name fighters that you really wanted to see face each other. You know, like, maybe talk about Faber Edgar.
Sure. Yeah, that's a good example. Or like I already named Evans, Rampage. I think Faber Edgar might be the one. Actually, that's a pretty good shout. So, but send us your suggestions if you have any others on Twitter. Yeah. Or whatever. Zane, I'll let you. I'm used to you doing it on the Vivisection, so I will let you tell them.
You can find us on Twitter at TheZaneSimon. You can find at BoxingBush. That's BUSCH. You can find my email if you want to email me suggestions it's just ZaneSimon@gmail.com. No mystery there. We'll put this on Bloody Elbow, so you can comment there. You can hit us up on any forum, wherever you find us. That's fine. Give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed watching it over on YouTube. That helps us a bunch. Subscribe to MMANation.com. That's DOTCOM, our YouTube channel. That's where you find all our latest Bloody Elbow shows, interviews, analysis, all that. I'm probably going to be doing another cross promotion. I need to get somebody who's good with stats, so I'm going to talk about MMA statistics. And we'll have, we had If I Did It this week, and we'll have Knuckle Up coming up this weekend and all that good stuff. Heavy Hands next week, and If I Did It next week, all our normal stuff. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.